This is an important video where we put the math aside and talk more generally about sinusoids. And we'll do that by addressing these fundamental questions. Questions you probably have had lingering at the back of your mind. Why did we talk about mathematical periodic functions in the context of audio? And what does a sine wave actually represent in the real world? And why does sinusoidal motion create a pure tone? Let's address the first question. And I'm sorry to say this, but we'll have to throw away a lot of what we learned over the last few videos. The reason we talked about triangles and circles previously was to derive the wave equation, an equation that we can plug into an audio system and generate any type of sinusoidal waveform. So we'll keep that. We'll keep the wave equation because it's relevant for audio purposes. But what does a rotating circle have anything to do with audio and how it's generated? Well, it doesn't really. The possible conclusion that you may have arrived at after having watched the last couple of videos is that sine waves are intricately linked with circles and originate from circles. That's not strictly true. In fact, the opposite is true, where circles are a consequence of sinusoids. Let's look at sinusoidal motion along a single dimension, like you see here, where the dimension is along the y-axis. Here's the same body with the same motion along the x-axis. Now let's combine the two dimensions of motion together. We get the body following the path of a circle. This is exactly what we described previously when we said that every point on a circle can be equated to a coordinate of the cos and the sine functions of a radian angle. But now, we're implying that the circle is only in existence due to the combined two-dimensional harmonic motion of a body. It's a chicken and egg problem, essentially. It's all a matter of perspective. Motion described by a sine function, or simple harmonic motion, happens every day in real life. In the example of a weight pulling down a spring, or a pendulum swinging, or a string vibrating, we can see that the motion is naturally fast at the resting point if the body were not moving, and naturally slow when grinding down to a halt at the extreme ends of its range. The sine function merely describes and quantifies this shape or motion. If we were to make the motion linear, for example, you can see how robotic, awkward, and unnatural the motion looks. The next question, which is quite a profound one, is what does the wave equation actually represent? We know that y of t equal to a sine 2 pi f t plus phi describes a simple sine wave, and we know that this periodic wave is what produces a pure tonal sound. But what is y of t here? What physical attribute in the real world does this wavy motion represent? It's not the amplitude or volume, since we have a stably loud signal. The answer will most definitely spill over into several other modules, since it is fundamental to different areas of study. But I'll try to race through it here anyway, just to cover all the basics. The answer to the question is that it depends. It depends on the domain and the context. In the domain of the physical world, where we live and breathe, the wave motion y of t represents the rise and fall of pressure. In the analog and electrical world of cables and wires and speakers, it represents voltage. In the digital world of computer and audio interfaces, it represents arbitrary bits of zeros and ones. We haven't talked about pressure or voltage or data bits before, and we will in more detail. But just glossing through, when a guitar string is plucked or when a vocal cord is strained, it starts vibrating, which in turn starts resonating and vibrating the air around it as well. The molecules of air around the source are imparted some amount of energy and are pushed away from the source, and they eventually collide and transfer some of their own energy to other molecules that they meet, kickstarting a chain reaction. This causes the molecules to first crowd together and then move apart. The alternate crowding together and moving apart of these molecules in turn affects the surrounding air pressure. The fluctuation of air pressure is propagated outwards till this resonance is transferred to the air next to our ear canal and it's interpreted as sound. So the wave equation in the physical domain represents the sinusoidal motion of the change in pressure over time. Or more simply, It describes a pressure wave. Now let's address the last question of why sinusoidal waves create a pure tone. The sinusoidal function describes the most basic form of periodic motion, motion that repeats itself periodically at regular intervals. And I can't stress this enough, that periodic motion is what gives rise to the perception of pitch. It doesn't have to be just a simple sine wave though. A complex waveform, which is still repeating itself at regular intervals, produces the perception of pitch. We've already seen and heard the sine wave before, countless times, so let's take the example of a harp playing a note. And here is its waveform zoomed in. We can see that this general shape seems to be repeating itself over and over again. Here's another example of a clarinet playing the same note. The waveform here is sufficiently more complex, but you can just about make out that it's actually a repeating waveform. Now, here's an example of a crash cymbal, which sounds inharmonic to say the least. You can't really associate this crash sound having any sort of pitch, and the waveform proves it right. There's no discernible pattern which repeats itself. This awkward notion that repeating patterns produce the perception of pitch may sit uneasy with you, but there is a good mathematical backing for this behavior, and we'll find out more when we talk about the harmonic series when we discuss other waveform shapes. But instead of trying to identify patterns by the tedious task of peering hard into complex waveforms, we can subject audio signals to a complicated mathematical transformation called the Fourier transforms, which can decompose a complex signal into many simple signals of distinct values. These values can then be plotted on a frequency response graph to see what a snapshot of the waveform looks like. And for the harp and the clarinet, we can clearly see distinct frequencies stand out, which we perceive and recognize as pitch. But the frequency response of a cymbal is all over the place, proving that there is no specific and discernible pitch associated with it. What about a sine wave then? If we decompose the sine wave with the help of the Fourier transforms, we get one value, and no more. Just one distinct value in the frequency response graph to showcase that the sine wave was decomposed into one simple signal, which is itself. This shows us that mathematically and physically, the sine wave represents the simplest possible periodic wave. And our ear is miraculously just a beautifully designed frequency analyzer, a mathematical transformation machine which lets us experience an auditory sensation of what these graphs visually represent. Hello there, folks. We've come to the end of the module on the origins of the sine wave, and I'd like to thank you for sticking with it. I've got a whole series of technical topics in the pipeline, all geared towards audio engineering, programming, and signal processing. So if you fancy the topics, the aesthetics, the approach of the previous videos, please do consider subscribing. There's going to be a lot more. And if you feel really generous, I've got a Patreon link down below. Until next time, then.